Welcome to Teachers Teaching Teachers. It's the 9th of November, 2011. It looks like we have some hip-hop freshness with us there, too. You guys want to join us, feel free. Yeah, I sort of put it...
I want to know how to do that choreography.
Anyway. And we have Carrie Ann with us, who's a video teacher from UCLA, video dance, I guess, who's involved in One Day on Earth, which Chris Sloan is going to tell us more about. And my screen just got all goofy here, so let me just widen something. Anyway, Fred Midland's joining us as well. And looks like Cynthia Schneider is with us. Did I get your last name right? Schneider, right? Cynthia, you there?
It's Schneider.
Okay. All right. From Alaska. And so let's start. Chris, why don't you introduce Carrie Ann and tell us about how you got involved in One Day on Earth and what that's all about. And Carrie Ann, maybe tell us more after that. Welcome.
All right. Well, I've got some background noise. I don't know if you can hear that, but
nope. We're good.
I've got some background eyes.
Yeah, yeah.
Guy with the eyes.
Yeah. But I came across the One Day on Earth project last week, about Thursday. And, Carrie Ann can talk about the project a little bit, but it's basically, a UN-sponsored event on 11-11-11 this Friday, where students, well, I look at it from a student perspective, where anybody around the world can video or photograph part of their day, and then it kind of creates this global mosaic of One Day on Earth. And so I'm going to have my students participate in that this Friday, and they're really excited about that. And I've talked to a few teachers in different countries who are also excited about their students' participation in this. And so that's enough of an introduction for me. Carrie Ann, how about telling us who you are?
Sure. My name is Carrie Ann, and I actually am one of the producers for the education project of One Day on Earth. And I wrote the toolkits. We have a set of 10 lessons that you can download. They're PDF lessons alongside slideshows and links with videos, so that you can actually have a 10 lesson format if you choose to do that. We also have projects that you can participate through with your students. So we have suggestions for projects if you only have one day to participate, projects like make a song in a day, or I think we have a beach project where you go to the beach and you film your local beach. We also have interview suggestions, and the toolkits are really useful. You could just use one lesson, or you could use all of the lessons. And we're looking for teachers like you to get your students involved to participate and hopefully to collaborate with other students and teachers around the world. So I'm here to just answer questions and help you guys get excited and interested and participate on Friday.
Tell us more of the sort of philosophy behind it. What's the idea? Mm-hmm.
Sure. Yeah. Sure. It's a global participatory media project. We have participants in every country of the world that will film on that day. And the actual philosophy was inspired by a global music concert 3 years ago at the Festival of Sacred Music. We saw several performers from all around the world come together and collaborate and make music together. And Kyle Ruddick, our founder, he thought, well, what if you did that with cinema? And that's where the idea was born. And so in order to get a better sense of the world, because we only have certain access to certain areas of the world, so we wanted to create a global online network where people could actually film what matters most to them and share it so that the rest of the world can see what's going on, places where we don't normally get to look at, stories we don't normally get to hear. So we created an online global map, and all of the footage from 10-10-10 has been put onto our map. So you can actually, as teachers and educators, you can search the map from 10-10-10 with tags. You can look at footage from all over the world and search for certain topics or certain areas. So it's a really great tool for your students to utilize. And then again, for this year, you'll be contributing to that map as well as a film that we make.
Carrie, can you tell us what your students have done
for this project? Sure. I've had students make a dance in a day. I've had students interview. We have an oral history project, and I've had students interview someone in their lives and post that. I've had students go to the beach, and one of my students did a tide pool project and filmed tide pools for the day and got a local tide pool specialist to come and he interviewed him and talked to him about tide pools. And this year we have students that are working together with other classrooms in other countries, which is really exciting, and I hope that perhaps you guys will take part in that as well.
So this is the first year with classrooms, is that right?
No, actually we had that last year as well.
Oh, okay.
Is that your donation, Paul?
That's mine, yeah. Don't know how to do this. How do you work? There you go. Did it work?
Such a great project. Have you seen the film I Am?
No, I haven't.
A lot of similarities, you know, after I watched what you guys did last year and that film. It's supposed to be coming out in January.
Cool. Writing it down. So do you feel like you will be participating, or do you have questions about how you can participate? We're down to 2 days, and I know if you're just finding out about it, it may seem really overwhelming, but it is quite easy to participate. You can simply have your students take a picture or a small video to upload, or you can be more adventurous and try a project or collaborate with someone that you find on our website.
Did we lose Chris?
Somebody sharing the link someplace.
What was that?
Is somebody sharing your link someplace? Paul, are you sharing that on, like, on your Google Hangout or on Teacher Teaching Teachers on that site?
Yeah, we'll do that. Sorry, low energy here. And it looks like we lost Chris. Where's Chris? Chris.
And Chris also had a list on his Google page of the places that are missing.
Yeah.
Right.
Have you got those filled, or are they still?
We're still working on it. And okay. If you go to our website on our main page, it's all listed there.
Great.
Yeah.
Great. Well,
it'll happen.
Why don't we check in with Fred and with Cynthia and see if they have any ideas? It looks like we have Vinny. I don't know, Vinny Menon? No, okay. I don't know. She waved. I don't know what that means. But Vinny might check in too. Fred, welcome. What's up with you, Fred?
Can you hear me okay?
We can hear you great.
Yes.
Good. Okay. So, well, I have
a couple of nice baby steps forward to report. I got approval finally from the principal at the middle school that I've been wanting to do the Maker Project with. And she's very excited. We're going to do a series of all staff digital storytelling trainings. Mm-hmm. And also she got very excited when I shared the project that I'm already doing with the Renaissance High School students, the continuation students, where we have a group of students who have been learning string games, and a week from Friday at our local Museum of Art and History, they're having what they're calling Radical Craft Night with people who do all different kinds of construction and crafts set up all over the museum. And we will have a little base corner. I just got in the mail today 300 preformed strings, really nice brightly colored strings with that are nylon, so you can burn them into a continuous loop with no knot. So they're perfect for doing string games. So we have a bunch of those we'll be giving away, and it just feels like one of those really exciting projects. I think the middle school students will definitely get involved, at least a few of them, and that'll be their introduction to the idea of making things. They'll see lots and lots of demos of people doing crafty things. And then hopefully we'll be able to put an after-school program in place where we pursue with them or some a similar kind of group the project that the museum curator has already gotten very enthusiastic about, which is to give the kids access to their collection of unknown objects, things they have in their archive that they don't even know what they are. And we'll discover and develop a process for how do we figure out what these things are, and then be documenting that as we do it. So I'm really jazzed about that connection finally coming through.
That's great.
That's me.
Fred, remind us what museum it is again.
It's called the Museum of Art and History. It's a kind of strange museum. There was a merger at some point way in the bygone years with an historical preservation association, and then other people who wanted an actual art museum. So it's both at the same time, and there's a whole floor that's kind of a stuffy, dusty historical exhibit, and then there are other floors where they do various art exhibits, and the whole place had a kind of stuffy feel for most of its history up until this last May when we got a new museum director, who's this young woman, Nina Simon, who's been traveling all over the world doing interactive museum exhibits with people. And so now she has her own museum to play with all these ideas. And she's just opened it up and brought in all of this stuff, like this, all these maker craft events. And it's becoming a really dynamic cultural center. And my hope is to be able to really include some Watsonville kids. Watsonville is a 20-minute drive, 14 miles away from Santa Cruz, and many of our kids in Watsonville don't get to Santa Cruz hardly ever. It's amazing. We just had a group where we were talking. I was talking about and many of the kids had never been to the ocean. The ocean is only a mile and a half from where I'm sitting right now. So, I mean, just getting out to places it is a huge breakthrough for, in terms of, you know, covering places where we don't hear from very often. I think about so many people who don't get even to the local places that are of interest where they live.
Hey, Paul, can we not have that slideshow?
What slideshow?
Or is that just me seeing that slideshow?
You can block it if you want. Yeah, you just
that's what I did.
You click on the window and block it.
I don't see it because I blocked it.
Hip hop freshness is, but I went ahead and blocked it too.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So, did that all start with like Dale Doherty?
Yes, this is a national writing project, nationwide grant, and we have the California through our local project, but there are groups from, I think, six other writing project local sites who have teams that are working on some kind of collaboration with Dale Doherty and Make Magazine and the Maker Faire.
Great. Very good. Yeah, we're trying to get one going here as well.
A Maker Faire where you are, you mean? Is that?
Who, me? Yeah. We've got a, NASA's bought out, it's an old Hewlett Packard building. It's a big complex and is bringing 7,000 jobs to the area. And so robotics, things like that are something that's, you know, one of the things on their hopes, and it fits in well with what we're doing. So we're requesting it now. We've got little maker fairs, but to have, you know, the big push. So did you actually, when you got yours jump started, did you have Dale come talk, or how did it
no,
start?
He, the launch was actually at the National Writing Project national meeting a year ago.
Yeah, where Dale was.
He was there and presented. Dale presented there, and then we went to the Maker Faire last May, and got to meet him there as well.
Yeah, I met him last.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
He presented. I've been to Providence, the BIF, Business Innovation Factory, very similar to TED meetups once a year, and he was there last year. Uh-huh. And then had a little maker fair afterwards. It was pretty impressive, you know. So,
right.
And the kids love it. I mean, big kids, all kids, any kids love it. So.
Well, we get to be kids when we're making things, right?
Say that again.
I said we all get to be kids when we're making things. So, yeah.
Yeah, we've penned youth to be you to whatever degree you decide, you know. Mm-hmm.
Cool. Well, I love. There's a phrase that Dale uses about what he's interested in is having people understand the built world and how we can change it. which, you know, the idea of making a clear distinction between the natural world and the built world. You know, I have a regular practice myself, and I try to introduce this to students of imagining what whatever it is you're looking at would be like if there were only the things that volunteer there, the things that come from nature and are supported by nature, not the things that people have put there. And it's just a really interesting exercise to try to remove that and see what's left.
Another angle I really like is the idea of, you know, prototyping and shipping without it having to be perfect, you know, because so many think everything that they would want to do is ridiculous. And if you've looked at any of the things that showcases. There's quite a bit of ridiculous there, and you know, just the freedom that we all get from. There's nothing really that's ridiculous, you know, so.
Chris, could we come back to you now that you're back? And
yeah, sorry, my computer froze.
I figured something.
So, looks like we were talking about the Maker Faire.
Yeah, but one of the things we got cut off on was thinking about what you're going to be doing or what we're going to be doing on our classrooms for one day on Earth. We were hoping you would fill in some of that. Welcome to Shantanu Saha, I'm super fired up about
11-11-11 because like all my students are really caught up in this thing that I just sprung on them. You know, they're really good at it. They spring stuff on me all the time too. So
and now you're springing it on us. So go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah. But you know, I was really amazed by, at first when I broached the topic with them, I said, oh, you know, I just came across this website, you know, what do you guys think? You know, and they immediately took to it because they're just fascinated by, other people, you know, so like, that's one of the reasons they like Youth Voices is this connection with people, who we don't know and who are different than we are. And so my students are attracted to that, I guess. And then when I started showing them some samples of some of the products from 10-10-10, you know, it was right up our alley, like with particularly with my photography classes and my video classes and then my new media groups. You know, they're really interested in the footage that took place just one day on Earth last time, because you know, if you look at those things, it's an interesting way to spend your day if you've got some time tomorrow in your class, just clicking on some of the staff pics on that site. So like for instance, I showed him this guy in Antarctica, you know, it was 80 below zero and he's out there just talking about his telescope and his job. You know, it's this fascinating description of this job. He studies the edges of the universe on Antarctica through this massive telescope, and it's just him talking about this thing. And I had a couple kids who were like, whoa, you know, I would love to do that. So on the one hand, you see these vignettes of people who are doing these jobs that my students are interested in finding more out about. And then, like, you know, we went to this Pacific island that was planting mangroves because, you know, their island's going to be sunk fairly soon if we keep doing the things we're doing as a culture. So it's kind of their appeal to the rest of us to cut down on emissions and that kind of thing. You know, and then just there was a New Zealander who did a time lapse photography thing of just kind of his harbor. And you know, like I have a kid who's in Youth Voices, if you've noticed, the guy who's doing a lot of time lapse stuff with stars and things, mm-hmm. his night photography. You know, he shoots thousands of frames overnight just to get the effect of stars moving.
Those photographs have gone well with my student who's doing an inquiry with Dream and what Dream's
yeah.
about. But anyway, yeah.
It's yeah, cool. So anyway, so, you know, I pitched, yeah, well, you know, why don't we do our little segment of the globe and let's talk about education. And again, I didn't know if they would go with this or not, but I said, you know, what do we want to focus on? What can be a thread of what we do? And so the first question is, what did we learn today? You know, if ostensibly we're in this institution that's about education, you know, what do we actually learn? And so I don't know what's going to happen, but, you know, we're going to document some things like that. And the other question is, how should schools be different? You know, how can we improve things? And the last thing I'm going to say, because I've been rambling quite a bit, is... you know, this is tied to the UN and their Millennium Goals. And so I'm also having my students look at the Millennium Goal of education and the idea that, you know, everybody should have an elementary education, everybody on the planet by the year 2015. And, you know, that's an ambitious goal, but I think it's important for my students to be thinking about education you know, from a global perspective, like all those goals are having us do. So anyway, my guys
are just really excited about this Friday. I could go on about the ideas they have that they just came up with. But I think it'll be fun. And then there are some other teachers, particularly in Mexico, Argentina, and Taiwan, who have said, hey, we'd like to collaborate with you. So, Carrie Ann, I think the project is just well conceived in a lot of fun, but really, you know, ultimately, it's going to teach us some important stuff.
We're hoping, we didn't get to do it this past year, but we're hoping for this year, for 11-11-11, to create a smaller piece of only student work. So for 10-10-10, we're creating a feature-length doc using everything, our selects from 3,000 hours of footage. But for this next time around, we actually just did a TED talk in Jackson Hole and connected with the TED guy there, and he was asking for a film just using the students' footage, which I would love to make that happen this year. So.
Carrie Ann, has anybody asked you to share any of that at the Global Ed Conference that's next week?
No, I don't think we're in... I'm not sure if we're in touch with them. I'd have to ask Daniel, the other education producer. Right now, we're really focused on Friday.
Right,
so.
Yeah, of course.
But that would be great.
I was thinking of even showcasing something from last year, you know, on that. Perfect timing right before that. And then again, I want to reiterate the I Am movie. Just all of it. Just to, I'm just finishing up reading Kathy Davidson's Now You See It. And one of the main things, I always think in fractals and thinking that we're each individually a culture, an eclectic within ourselves. And then global, you know, country-wise we are and globally we are. And she talks about, you know, in order to see that global perspective, we need to go outside of ourselves. And what a great way, you know, what you're doing. I remember watching all that the stuff that was coming in last year, and just it makes you pause and say, oh, dang, it's not just me, you know? And that perspective is just so important. So I love what you guys are doing.
Thank you.
Go ahead. I was just going to say, I'd toss it out to everybody that really, you know, you ought to just try to pitch it tomorrow and see if you have any takers, because I would bet there would be a few kids who would be interested in just doing a little segment of their, you know, existence and their place. Carrie Ann, I mean, what do you say to people who are just hearing about this and it's the day after tomorrow?
I send them to the website. I say, go to the website and check it out. Kids these days are very technologically driven, and they love social media. So if you can get them to click on that page and check it out, they're going to want to do it. If you can get them to look at the, and teachers alike, if you can just look at the global archive and look at some of the footage from around the world, it's so inspiring. And you see all of this new information, and it makes you inspired to want to add to that archive. And also to connect with other people that are on the website already. It's become a really great network for teachers to connect with each other, and actually just, you know, citizens around the world to connect with each other and share ideas and thoughts. And even we've had participants who have visited each other, and we've produced films in other countries. We've helped network different projects through the site.
That's great. Yeah. And I would say one day is nothing. Flip video, or let them take their phones out of their pockets for just one day. You can have video footage right there.
To that end, I did tell my students that, you know, they need to give the teachers the heads up. But, you know, to be ready with their cell phones and to just tell people what it is we're doing. You know, I've prepped our staff and have said, you know, if it's okay, you're going to see some smartphones out there documenting things. But we also talked about the sensitivity. You know, this is not a hidden camera kind of thing. It's like a documentary. And so I told them, you know, turn the lens on yourself.
Right, right.
And I think that's a good message for the teachers. I mean, if we really want the kids to be involved, you know, start your day with showing them you're doing it, you know.
We have underneath, I believe it's additional materials on the education page, we have a downloadable PDF that outlines our guideline to interviews. And that's a great one page or two page tool to look at with the students and just say, you know, kind of the do's and don'ts of using a camera and interviewing people. And that's a nice place to start with them once they agree to do it. I would also encourage your students, if you're working as a class on a project, that's really great. You can also encourage your students to do their own independent projects as well. And that's where you really see them bloom.
And just one other thing is, you know, there's a similar project that, you know, was at Sundance, which is our local, or, you know, it's an international film festival, but it was called Life in a Day. And I don't know if anyone's seen that, but, you know, another interesting kind of film that some people compare, because it's like, you know, a lot of people uploading their stuff about their day, right? But but it comes back to the UN thing is kind of, you know, I've mentioned it before, but, you know, it's a lot more tied into the Millennium Goals. Is that fair to say, Carrie-Anne?
Right. Life in a Day, actually, we were partnering with Google and YouTube, and we were going to use them as our platform. And we got a rude awakening when they told us that they were going to jump our date and do the same idea before we did. So that's the truth of the matter. And the difference, I think, between the two projects is that we're grassroots and we're the real deal. And we've been working on this since 2008. And it's not for anything other than passion. And we have partnered with the UN, and we have all of these cause organizations that we've partnered with that Life in a Day actually went after. And so it's been a bit of a battle between the two groups, but in the end, we are here to create the archive and to create the network and to help the world see more of itself and to learn more about itself. And we're a long-term cause, and we're very rooted in education, and we're very rooted in the UN support, who they've pledged to be with us through 2015. And we're very committed to all of our causes and organizations that we're working with, like 350.org and the WWF, and to name a few. So it's interesting. We get compared to them all the time, but I really think that they were just trying to steal the idea and jump our date and do it first. And we, in the end, I think we'll have a much stronger community and a much stronger project. And it actually really solidified our team and really gave us more fire to make it happen. Did any of you see the film, Life in a Day?
Yeah, I've seen it.
No, I haven't.
But can you say a little more about how participating in this connects us to the UN, the Millennial Goals, and to 350 and so forth? Like, how does it help those organizations? Is it just awareness building? Is that what it is, or is there more?
Well, those organizations are using our project as a way to document what they're doing in the world and share it through our vehicle. In our archive and also in our feature film. The UN has donated camera teams on ground to cover some of the situations that they're dealing with. And so this is a great vehicle for the UN. We went and spoke to them last April, or two Aprils ago, I believe, in 2009. And they are just craving vehicles to show the work that they're doing, because they are doing all this work but have nowhere to show it. And so they were really excited about the project and wanted to collaborate with us. And so now bringing all of these causes and orgs together along with the United Nations, you bring in your citizens of the world and you bring in teachers and students, and they now have a direct access to these groups. So you could partner with one of the groups. You could partner with the UN. They have different projects going on that you can find out about and partner with them. So it's become this great cohesive network for people to find out what other groups are doing and also to perhaps participate with them or just learn about what they're doing.
And Paul, on, you know, on Youth Voices, we've got this local knowledge global
attitude.
I forget the channel name.
Attitude.
But global attitude. Yeah. You know, like I started thinking about, you know, how you were researching the famine this summer and put up a lot of information about that. And, you know, I was clicking around on the map and we came across this one film. I forget what African country, but it was this thing about water cards, or, you know, you have to pay for your water and you're allotted just X amount. And so it's another way that, you know, it kind of brings some of the stuff that our students have been writing about on Youth Voices. You know, it gives it a, you know, a pretty real perspective when you have just raw footage of stuff. Because a lot of the videos that I've seen are kind of advocacy, you know, especially about the environment, I've noticed. And so, like, it's a way for my students to get kind of just a raw look at some of those issues. Cynthia, how about you up in Alaska? Could you see yourself turning loose a kid or two?
Yeah. You know, my teaching schedule right now is I've got little pockets of kids throughout the day. And so what I was thinking about is it would probably work best with my son and his friends just going out after school and doing some documentation. But one thing I was thinking about is I've got a friend who does a lot of video with her students in Brevig Mission, where they're it's up in the Bering Straits area where they're getting hit by a storm right now. I mean, really severe coastal storm. And so I'm going to ask her if she's interested in submitting some footage, because that's just tied into what she does on a day-to-day basis. And I've got another friend in Anchorage who might be able to do like an urban Alaskan perspective with her students, because she's got she's got a very innovative, creative sort of teaching situation there. So, yeah, I'm going to reach out to these two teacher friends and see what they can pull together. But, yeah, I think we'll take the flip video out here in Valdez, and I'm going to see what my son and his friends do. And definitely want to check out the website. This is exciting.
Great.
And
we definitely need footage from Alaska. That's definitely something we're looking for.
Cool. Shantanu, introduce yourself. Tell us the name of your school, given what we're talking about here. Oh, we can't hear you. No sound. You're muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes. Hi.
Yes, I'm Shantanu Saha. I'm a teacher at the Baccalaureate School for Global Education. In New York City, and sorry, I just came on a little bit late, but I had to
put a little
my
one
son
down
to sleep, and so.
How old is your son now?
He's 10 months old now.
Wow.
And so I just came in the middle of this conversation and sort of hearing snippets and trying to get myself up to speed. So. I think I'm a little bit up to speed now. I think I know what we're talking about.
By the way, earlier it was asked what the website is, and it's a very simple, it's just onedayonearth.org. Is that correct?
Right.
Okay. Yeah. So Shantanu, can you imagine some of those some of your students jumping in, up on this, or we in New York City we're off on Friday for Veterans Day, so we'll have to kind of figure that out. And I wanted to ask a question about that. Like, what if I get some kids excited tomorrow and then we don't get stuff up till Monday? Does that kind of work, or how does that work?
All you need to worry about now is just getting them to shoot on Friday on the 11th. And uploading can take as long as you need. You can upload raw footage. You can also take longer and edit your footage and upload that at a later date. We will have a cutoff time that you need to upload by, but that probably won't be until January. So last year we had a date of December and we shot in October. So this year we're shooting in November. So I believe our cutoff date for uploading will be sometime in January.
Shantanu, back to you a little bit.
Yes.
What are you guys working on, and might this fit somehow?
I'm trying to figure out how to make it, how it might fit. And I'm also trying to figure out how I could do this, because as it is tomorrow, I'm taking the entire 10th grade out on a field trip to the library. So, hey. You know, introducing this to them is something that, you know, between the library tour and the research that they're supposed to be doing in their personal projects, it's difficult to see how I can actually work this in a whole day thing.
Tell us more about that project. What are you doing about your project?
The 10th graders are all working on a personal project, well, for me this year, I'm a little bit disconnected from most of the 10th grade, because the only thing I have, the only group of them I'm teaching is an advisory, so I'm not teaching any large group of them. Just I have 17 kids in my advisory, and there are 68 kids in the grade. So so I don't know really what everyone is doing, except for the fact that this weekend I have to look at all their proposals. But they have to do research around a topic of their interest, and then come up with some kind of product to show off this newfound knowledge. And they're going to be exhibiting that later on this year. Okay. And most of them are doing PowerPoint presentations, which to my mind would make them the most boring possible products they can make. So I'm trying to get more of them to do videos or anything, create things, build things. Those are the sorts of things that make really engaging really engaging projects that other students would like to see. But students have gone to taking what they think is the easy route, and it really ends up doing not much for their own personal development, because anyone can do a PowerPoint badly, and that's what they mostly do.
Because we model it so well.
I would say that, you know, I had a kid who said, well,
we had
an
interesting moment. There was a weekend.
Fred, go ahead if you hear us.
That's all right.
Go ahead.
We did our fall conference for the writing project this last Saturday, and there were three different presenters, including me, all of whom decided at the last minute that we had to do our presentations in the form of a Prezi, and so had this sort of crash course feeling of trying to figure out how to make this thing work. And the at least I had a little bit of experience, so I was able to do it fairly straightforwardly, but I had two other people tell me I was up until 2 a.m. trying to get my PowerPoint over into a Prezi. Just interesting what is in vogue.
We're funny people.
Yeah.
Back to there's nothing that's too ridiculous, right?
Yes, so I had a student who said, you know, I'm not really interested in school. And, you know, I don't want to film at school or anything. Can I do what I do after school? Which is, you know, he goes outdoors as far as he can away from things. And so, you know, he's doing something that, you know, is not related ostensibly to school anyway. But really it's about, you know, I still think he's going to reflect on things he's learned and, you know, how school should be different or how education could improve, those kinds of things. So yeah. I think it's pretty flexible.
Hopefully soon there won't be that distinction, right? School's over, now I can live, or, you know.
Right.
We're headed that way.
Chris, that theme that you've come up with your students, that's not a theme for one day on Earth, is it? That's just your particular, and so talk a little bit about why you want to do that theme, and then maybe Carrie, if we could come back to you and hear what some other, like, are there themes that people can focus on, or how does that work? Chris first.
So just how I came up with it, or, you know, my students and I came up with it. You know, we just thought that the majority of most of their day that day is going to be revolved around the building, because we also have a drama production that night. So I have a number of them who will basically just be here from, you know, 7:30 in the morning until 10 o'clock at night.
Bye bye.
So they just thought, you know, we're going to be here. And so we're going to be thinking about school a lot and, you know, our education and all that. And they think about that a lot anyway. But that said, you know, that's not what everybody's doing. I'm just saying that that's a possibility for some of us to do. But the kid who's going out after school and going to try to find some powder, you know, that's going to be his thing. And, you know, I have the student who's doing the time release photography. You know, that's not really probably going to touch on my theme directly. So I think a lot of us will be doing that, but really, you know, what Carrie Ann's probably going to mention are a lot of other possibilities that some of my students will probably fall easily into those categories too.
I'm going to post a link in the chat that will take you directly to our education page. And there's some drop down bars there. If you click on projects, we have suggested projects that are created for teachers who only have maybe one day to work with the students. So these are just suggestions that you may want to do, and they might inspire other ideas as well. Just simple topics.
Yeah, what are some of those?
Okay, so we have support a cause, we have write a song.
Make a dance in a day.
Make a dance in a day.
How can you not
know? We have a, let's see, your meals project, which is one of my favorite, is to document the meals that you eat throughout the day. That could even be like a photography project. If your students don't have access to video cameras, they could just take a picture of each meal that they eat that day. We also have oral history project, where the students would interview someone in their life and do an oral history. We have historic photograph recreation projects. So that's one of my favorites. If you have your students find a historic photo that's in your local area and then they recreate it that day. That's a fun one to do, and they can get really funky with that. So those are a few of them. There's more on that link. The ones that we had come in last year were the Making a Meal project and the Looking at Money project. We had kids filming their money, and also a lot of oral tradition, oral history projects, and Days at the Beach projects.
What's the money project? How does that work? You film your money.
Right. You take photographs, or you film all the different pieces of currency in your country. And then you can also go further with that and film yourself spending the money and what you buy, kind of documenting the use of money in your day.
Mm-hmm. Nice. And did these come from people doing them? And then you said, oh, that's a cool project. We could put that out for other people.
No, actually, they came from a huge brainstorm session with myself and the other producers of the education team. We spent a long time trapped in an office coming up with different ideas.
So we're coming sort of to a close, but could you describe that team a little bit more? Like, who do you work with?
Sure. The main writers of the toolkits were myself and Daniel Lichbaugh, who's one of our producers of the entire project, as well as Kyle Reddick, who's the founder. The three of us primarily wrote the toolkits, and we were really interested in creating new and better definitions and ways of talking about social media and filmmaking. Mm-hmm. And we also had Anna B. Scott, who was our editor, and she's our PhD on board. We also had some people that were consulting us, Jay Silver from MIT, and we had a couple other consultants that are listed, but it was just the core three of us that really did most of the writing, and myself that lifted the major cross of the toolkits. We're going to check in with them and actually rewrite and make newer versions for 12-12-12 for next year. So we are looking to our teachers for feedback and ideas to add.
Cool. What happens after 12-12-12?
we were just asked that question on our we did a live feed earlier today, and Kyle said there's 11-12-13 that date. And basically he really wants to create a day that happens once a year that's like a holiday, like a global filmmaking holiday that can nest on a very specific date. So that's his ultimate goal. So after 12-12-12, hopefully we could settle on some sort of date that we could have reoccurring every year and just continue the archive growing.
Great. Carrie, that was a great summary, actually, but any other thoughts you'd like to leave us with?
It's easy. All you need is a camera. Go to the website. Check it out. If you're afraid that you don't have enough time to explain it to your students, all you have to do is give them the link to the website. They'll figure it out for themselves. They're really savvy with this stuff. So if you're worried about time, just tell them and let them check it out. And I think they'll be able to come up with something very easily. So I really hope that you guys participate and continue to participate and watch us and be with us and help us grow.
And I love that we're using Google tools tonight to put that out there. Anyway.
Right. Yeah, thank you guys.
Anyway, I think we should just come to an end here, although it looked like somebody interesting coming on here. But thank you so much.
I know that.
You do? Okay.
Are you really there?
Raul.
Yeah. Huh. Maybe not. We'll catch up with that later. Thank you, Chris and Monica and Cynthia and everybody else here at Shantanu and earlier Fred. And we do want to say, as we're closing off here, that we've been broadcasting over the EdTech Talk channel of the World Bridges Network. And we've had two shows in a row here now about global issues, so that's interesting. Thank you all. We want to thank Dave Cormier and Jeff Lebo, who hooked up that network for us and keep us inspired in lots of ways. Thank you all, and we'll see you next week.
All right.
Thanks.
Good night.
Bye.
Thank you.
Good night.
Night.